tea, coffee, and plenty of very healthy fruit, amongst other things. I think we're in for another exciting session. My gosh, you've only gone and see what's in this mix. Illicit drugs, alcohol, and fatigue. My gosh. I think that we're going to have a lot to think about. And so I'm going to welcome our first three presenters. It's going to be tag teams again. And the first speaker is going to be Peter Palomara, research fellow, again, at our Curtin Monash Accident Research Centre, honours degree in psychology, and master's in public health. And you know, I visited a lot of schools, and one of the most popular subjects now for students who are going to do the ATAR score is to do psychology. And psychology is going to be right through everything we talk about in this session. What's driving us to do what we do? So Peter, great that your degree is in that, with a master's in public health. Been involved in road safety research since 1995. Main interest, youth, risk-taking and driving, impaired and distracted driving, policing and enforcement, road safety programs, design and evaluation. And you're current secretary of the WA chapter of the Australasian College of Safety. So Peter, it's going to be fantastic. Now, the next person I'm going to tell you about is Scott Higgins. Let me find Scott here. So Scott joined the police force in 1986, served in a variety of local policy and detective roles across the metropolitan area. Roles included 5 years investigating homicides. So you must have so many deep things that you have dealt with. It's just, I think, extraordinary to hear. Very involved in identifying officers at risk of misconduct. My gosh. Always make sure that we're looking at getting things right. Very important. Worked at the Central Metro Police District. Has been taken the role of principal of WA Police Academy. And in 2015, acted as the director of human resources for WA Police. 2016, appointed the role of commander of the State Traffic Command. Congratulations. Responsible for traffic enforcement activities across the state. And the third of our terrific trio, Sharon Wilson from the Road Safety Education Coordination Unit, the School Drug Education and Awareness Program. State government's primary strategy, this is for road safety and drug education. Secondary health and physical education teacher, yay for teaching. Ian, there's nothing like a background in teaching to get you ready for the world. It's no more important job, I always say that. 20 years plus experience with government and independent primary and secondary schools, and over the past 10 years you've been writing the curriculum resources and presented professional learning for educators. Let's welcome the trio, starting with Peter. Illicit drug-related crash and offences.
Thank you, Professor Beasley, and thank you to the Road Safety Commission, Melissa Morgan and Ian, for putting this day on and allowing us to showcase some of the work that you have so kindly sponsored for us. Firstly, I'd like to acknowledge my friends and colleagues at government agencies and at CMARC who have assisted with this work. This is the first stage of an investigation into illicit drugs and driving. A bit of background about illicit drugs and driving. There is a substantial body of research looking at the potential impairing effects of illicit drugs on risky behaviour and related to crash risk. I have to say, though, after a critical review, the level of evidence isn't as definitive as it is for our understanding of alcohol and crash risk and driving impairment. Even so, what we do find is that jurisdictions across Australia, including Western Australia, have introduced zero tolerance laws, so we enforce illicit drug driving laws in this country, and indeed Victoria was the first jurisdiction in the world to do so in 2003 to conduct a roadside oral fluid testing program. In regards to what we understand about the prevalence and incidence, it really does depend upon the research methods here, whether you're asking people about self-reports of driving whilst under the influence of drugs, or you're undertaking roadside oral fluid testing, or you're looking at fatal crashes And there was a very large three-state 10-year study, and it was published prior to 2000, and that was the period up to when we last had our understanding of drugs in Western Australia. It was about 23.5%. It was interesting that the Minister pointed out this morning about the relationship between illicit drugs and alcohol, and it certainly is the case that when the two are combined, there is the potential for greater risk here, and that certainly has put a bit of a focus on how we undertake roadside testing and our legislation in this regard. So our overall aim, I guess, for our research work was to try and better inform the state about the incidence of illicit drug driving, and also to provide WA police with some intelligence about who's most at risk of illicit drug driving. So our first objective was really to understand the incidence rate of illicit drug driver related deaths for that period 2000 to 2012. And when I use the term driver, I do actually include motorcycle riders in that as well. And we were also interested in understanding the incidence of what we call Section 64AC offences, which are offences related to driving with an oral fluid in blood or saliva for that period 2008 to 2012. And we've focused on 2008 to 2012 because roadside oral fluid testing commenced in October 2007. And so what we have done is just looked at that period from the first full year of testing. And we also wanted to understand something of the characteristics and risk factors of these drivers who were killed in crashes and had an illicit drug in their system and those that were offending as well. So something about our research methods here. It is what we call a retrospective design, and that means that we're looking back in time. We're looking at crashes that have already occurred. We're not looking forward at crashes that are occurring. So that's in relation to fatalities and also for offences that have occurred in the past. In terms of the data extractions, we work very closely with the Chem Centre here, who do the toxicology assays of drivers and road users who are involved in fatal crashes on the road. And they were able to extract out their records for 2000 to 2012, send them to police, and police link them with their records of fatalities. And we have, for this analysis, we looked at 1,375 driver and rider deaths, and that actually represented about 90% of fatalities, 90% of driver and rider fatalities for that period. So there's about 10% where we couldn't get information on. Police were also kind enough to provide us with aggregated roadside oral fluid test operations data. So in other words, we had information about where the test was conducted, the date of the test, and they also supplied us with what we call de-identified unit records. So drivers who actually tested positive and were initially charged there, we had their records, which actually indicated their age, their gender, where the offence took place, and also what drugs were actually detected, which led to an offence against them.
They haven't been in crashes?
No, not these drivers. This is a result. The offences are a result of roadside oral fluid testing. Okay. In our research methods, once we estimated the incidence rate for fatalities and Section 64AC offences, we undertook linear regression to see whether things had changed over time. We also took some univariate descriptive analyses to understand these characteristics. And in the case of the fatalities, we did some multivariate modelling to try and identify which drivers were most at risk of when they were fatally injured, that they had an illicit drug in their system. This was going to provide some important information for police, which they could use for roadside enforcement as well. Now, I'm only going to present a very small sample of the findings here, but if you would like the full report, you can actually go to our webpage and download the report. Moving on to the first slide of the findings. This slide actually shows you the incidence rate and the 95% confidence intervals. And the rate is per 100,000 motor vehicle driver licences. So this is the rate of drivers who were killed with a fatal substance in their system. And as you can see, there was a lot of variation over time, and it did actually jump up in 2007, which is interesting. That's when roadside oral fluid testing was introduced, and you can see that it's as low as 1.17 back in 2012. In 2000, about 21% of drivers and riders who were fatally injured had an illicit substance in their system. In 2012, it was 24%. For the period, it's about 22.3%. There's no significant change in that rate over time. Now, about 80% of these drivers that had an illicit drug in their system at death had only one illicit drug in their system. But there is a relationship with alcohol, which I'll talk about in the coming slide. Methamphetamine was detected in about 27% of these fatally injured drivers over time, and that proportion did actually significantly increase over time. But the other substance, cannabis, which is measured as THC, there was no significant change over time in that. And the other prescribed substance that police actually check for at roadside is ecstasy. And there was very little ecstasy in these fatally injured drivers and riders. So what are the factors then that are associated with drivers returning a positive illicit drug upon their death in a crash? Anything in excess of one shows increased risk here, and I guess it comes as no surprise that males had nearly 60% increased odds of having an illicit drug in their system when they were fatally injured, and that is relative to females there. Moving on, to those that are under 40 years of age had nearly four times the odds of having an illicit drug in their system when they were fatally injured, and that is compared with drivers of 40 years and older. Again, I think that's not necessarily surprising to people. As this third risk factor here, license status. So those at the time of the crash who were fatally injured and found to have an illicit drug in their system, they were nearly three times more likely to have an illicit drug in their system compared with the licensed driver. And as many in this room know, the licensed drivers are particularly problematic on the road because they're more often not wearing seatbelts and more often speeding and more often involved in alcohol-related crashes as well. Alcohol turned out to be a significant issue here. You can see two levels of alcohol here, double the risk of that driver also having an illicit drug in their system. And indeed, about nearly 50% of these fatally injured drivers that had an illicit drug in their system had a BAC of 0.05 or higher. So that tells you something about the relationship between these two substances. And when you throw into the mix that drivers who were also tested positive for benzodiazepines upon their death had nearly three times the risk of having an illicit drug in their system. So what you're seeing here is a bit of a cocktail of mix.
They're legal, aren't they?
Benzodiazepines are legal, and benzodiazepines in their own right are a significant risk factor for
depression.
Well, they're, yeah, calmative. They're CNS depressants, basically. All right, let's look at the offences here. So what we've charted here is the offence rate per 100,000 motor vehicle driver licences and the offence rate per 1,000 oral fluid tests conducted. So remember, this is only the first 5 years of roadside oral fluid testing program. And there was, on average, about 8,600 tests conducted each year for this first 5 years. And you can see, looking at that red bar down the bottom, there was about 32.9 offences per 1,000 tests back in 2008, and that equates to about a hit rate or a positive rate of about 3.3. And in 2012, it jumped up to 54.8. And there was a significant change over time in offending per 1,000 tests, such that on average for each year, about six offences per 1,000 tests increase over time here. What is particularly interesting about the offences for oral fluid here? They wanted to scan me. That's been done enough. what is interesting about these offences here, that more often than not, we're going to find methamphetamine here. Whereas for the fatalities, what we actually find is cannabis is more likely to be present. Okay. What we have found over time, that the incidence of methamphetamine is actually increasing as well. And I guess if you understand that the popular media, you can see that methamphetamine is increasing across the community, and it's showing up on our roads here. So I've spoken about that. About 86% of offences involved methamphetamine, 34% of offences involved THC as well. We don't know about the involvement of alcohol here. What are the risk factors? Again, similar to what we found with the fatalities, males and those under 40 years of age are more likely to account for these offences. So what conclusions can we draw here? Illicit drugs are present in fatally injured drivers, but they're not present in the same extent as alcohol. Alcohol was about 33% in fatally injured drivers compared to nearly 23% here. But we do have this problem of co-use or poly-use of drugs here, or impairing substances such as alcohol, illicit drugs, and the benzodiazepines. And I think that presents a particular challenge for police. Now, in identifying who is at risk, this provides information for police in terms of how they might target their roadside oral fluid testing program. But we also need a random program as well to deter people from ever doing this, as opposed to being targeted and just identifying those who are affected by drugs at the time. But we also need further research to extend our profiling drivers. What we weren't able to do in this research was to link in licensing data. We'd like to be able to do that. Now, WA's roadside oral fluid testing program is, 10 years old now, or just over 10 years old, so it's time to evaluate this program to look at its full effect. And we also need to determine some of the best strategies for managing repeat illicit drug driving here. And most of the offences that we looked at in that period, people only had one offence, drivers had one offence, but other work we're doing actually shows a slightly different pattern, which is raising the spectrum of repeat drug driving. Thank you.
To present what school drug education and RoadAware has done with some of the research that we have heard today and research that has been presented previously. But first I'd like to set you the scene with a little bit of the background of Sidera. That's not my background. School Drug Education and RoadAware, with the long acronym of SIDERA, is the state government's primary strategy for addressing drug education and road education for youth in WA. So our spectrum is from the age of 0 to the age of 18 and moving beyond that as we move into community agencies. We use the research that we get along with best practice and evidence, throw it all together and come up with an action plan. Our action plan is all about prevention education. So we want to look at how we can change the decisions and the choices of our young people so that we are creating a safer environment and community for all of us. It's developed three programs that have a road safety basis, and I'll go into those in a moment. Our programs have had evaluations and are being monitored and reviewed internally, both formally and anecdotally, continually, and at checkpoints. We use the principles for school road safety from the ages of 4 to 18, and we also use the principles for early childhood education. Our Smart Steps program is led by our funky Izzy. That's a gender fluid and species fluid logo of a lizard dinosaur friendly green thing that often appears in lycra and fur at schools and community events. And Izzy is a point of reference for our children to create some kind of icon that they can look at and follow the behaviours that Izzy exemplifies. For our Smart Steps program, for our 0 to 8 people, we have trained education for educators, for our parents and their carers and the community. We are on committees that include WARSEC, more acronyms here. WARSEC is the WA Road Safety Education Committee that produces directions, a report that covers a period of 2 to 3 years that involves a whole pile of road safety industries and groups to make sure that we're on track and that we're also addressing the community need. And it also, we're also involved in Resurger, the Road Safety Education Reference Group of Australasia. The resources that we create as a result of the evidence, best practice and research that we gain from all our respected and esteemed colleagues here today for Smart Steps include things like facilitator guides, curriculum documents, lessons and activities, storybooks and signage, car seat restraint information, website, videos, and fact sheets. And these are accessible free from our website thanks to the Road Safety Commission and the RTTA. Trust account, yeah.
Sorry,
thank you, all these acronyms. Yeah. Thank you. Our CATE Year 9 program in schools is called Challenges and Choices. And again, it's about the safe choices that we can encourage our young people to make. The training education that we provide is for educators, for parents and carers, and for community members. Again, we are on committees. We chair the WARSEC committee and we are on the Resurger committee. And the resources around challenges and choices include a facilitator guide, again, curriculum documents, lessons and activities, website, videos, and fact sheets. These lists are examples and they are certainly not exhaustive of what we provide. Moving up to the older people now, the people who are in Year 10 and older, as we move into community agencies, we have our Kids for Life program. Can I have a show of hands of people who know of someone who have been through Kids for Life? Fantastic, love it, about half of you. And I've checked with our students that are here from Paul's Head, and they are graduates of our program for Kids for Life. Kids for Life was aimed originally at students who are in Year 10, so the 15 to 16 year olds, before they get their driver's license. We provide education and training for teachers, community agencies, and parents and their carers. We work through WARSEC and Resurger and provide facilitator guides, curriculum documents, lessons and activities, website videos, and fact sheets. Our evaluation for all of these projects is, as I've said before, it's formal and informal. What we'd like to see is how we can have our young novice drivers be made safer. How can we give them the knowledge, the understanding and the information so that their decisions are safer for themselves and for all of us on the roads. Our WARSET collaboration has membership across all of these organisations, and the directions publication is our action plan that keeps us all on track and accountable. And our Asurgia collaboration is Australasian. Moving forward, what we would like to do with research is to be able to track P-platers for the next 5 years of them having their licence to see if the graduates from Keys for Life do actually have lower accident risk, and if the learners and parents of novice drivers are completing the more than 50 hours of supervised driving that's recommended. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. I'm here to run you through our drunk driving testing program in WA, not to talk about speed cameras, but if you have some time later on, happy to dispel any myths or rumours that you may have about that and refocus your confidence in that area. Australia leads the way in a number of fields, sporting field definitely. Recreational drug use being another one. Our use of methamphetamine in the Western world, based on the wastewater sampling testing, has been shown over the last 4 or 5 years that we are, I think, in the top five, regularly the top two of drug users, particularly Western Australia. South Australia bumped us off the top list last year, and it wasn't so tragic in terms of, you could always make a joke out of it, but yeah, the effects of methamphetamine use on the roads and in our communities, it's beyond tragic. Anyway, so it's really enforces the need for us to maintain this. And I'll talk about the difference between drug testing on the roads and in terms of road safety outcome as opposed to dealing with it from a social aspect. So a bit of background, and I think I do need to talk about some of the technicalities and some of the tactical things that we do, because the testing program needs to explain for you to understand the restraints and the limitations that we have as to why we aren't doing more in a different way. But just the background though, so I've explained the acronym there, ROFT. It's not random, it's Roadside Oral Fluid Test. Brought into WA in 2007. It's coordinated by our breath and drug operations. So we have one unit that does our breath and drug operation, the coordination thereof in state traffic. And that looks after, the coordination of anyway across metropolitan and regional WA. Now, the bulk of the work is done using a large bus-style deployment. So you see the booze buses, as they're called. We call them the bad bus, as in breath and drug testing. And we don't see the irony there at all. And as you'll see shortly, this is where research is actually listened to, an increasing use in regional WA in terms of our drug testing particularly. There's a significant contribution from the Road Trauma Trust account, significant contribution there. And the number of our testing, apart from just the cost issue, the number and style of is influenced by research, conversations with government, but particularly around the financing and other resources, because it's a very, very labour-intensive process, as I'll explain very, very shortly. So the methodology, we've got two testing devices at the moment. And in the same way you have with a breath or an alcohol testing process, there's a preliminary test or the test which you do use to blow into the machine. But then if you blow to a positive, then we move you to a secondary or an evidentiary testing device. The process with drug testing is a lot more takes more time and it's more expensive and more labour intensive than breath testing. Breath testing is I think most of us, hopefully most of us who drive have been through a breath testing process at some stage or other and all passed with flying colours. I'm hoping, don't put your hands up if not, or you can, that's up to you. But the breath testing process takes 10 to 20 seconds, whereas the drug testing process takes a lot longer because there's a collection of saliva which needs to then be tested in the same way or in a similar kind of way as you might see with the pregnancy testers. So there's a line indicator which comes up and tells you whether it's positive or negative. That then moves to a secondary testing device, which is where we do our evidentiary collection. So there's two different ways we have. In the metro area, we've got manufactured by Draeger. There's a new device that we've just brought in recently. If you want to have a discussion with Diana Ho and Steve Tendy from our research area, they'll tell you all about how that process worked. That's a more portable device. It's not completely portable. It's not as not as portable as we would hope it would be. And that's the issue with the drug testing process. It's not as easy to run as people might think it is. The device needs to have two separate processes. The testing at the roadside, and then if there's a positive indication, we then move the person to another area where we need to then go through more of a collection process of getting saliva. There's some moving back and forth of different vials and there's liquids. So it's not really simple as blowing to the machine and away you go. There's a fair bit of collection that goes on, particularly to withstand the evidentiary court processes. The only test for, because these are the prescribed by legislation drugs, methamphetamine, cannabis, and MDMA or ecstasy. The methodology in Metro is predominantly done by the breath and drug buses. So we'll set the breath and drug buses up. There's a couple of different ways of doing it, but most of it is quite a random, when I say random, it's a large scale methodology of testing. In regional WA, we still use the buses in large scale deployments, but a lot more of those are done by single officer patrols or sort of single vehicle patrols, pulling people over and testing. And we use a combination of both those devices. Both end up being tested by the Chem Centre. So there's a lag, there's a time lag involved in prosecuting someone. Normally about a week or so, it's getting better. But it takes time for the sample to be collected, boxed up, labelled, sent into the Chem Centre, tested by the Chem Centre, returned to WA Police for us to then prosecute someone. Random versus targeted, and I'll discuss that shortly, but there are differences between how we might look at targeting locations, people, dates and times. So there are some differences around that. A random test would involve setting up the booze bus. You've all been through it by now, I'll say, earlier on, and we'll fill the line, as we call it, with cars. So there'll be 10 cars all lined up. We'll almost blow a whistle. We'll quarantine that lot, and everyone in that line will be tested. Doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, what you're driving, everyone is tested in that line. That's purely a random sample. Or there'll be a more of a targeted approach, and there's two ways of targeting. One is within that very random approach you do with the breath and drug bus. We'll target particular individuals based on the officer's experience and perception about who might be a good person to be targeted for a roadside drug test. Or the targeted test might be in a particular area where we'll go to areas where we think there might be a higher prevalence of drug use. And as I said before, we approach it from the point of view of road safety. It's not about targeting people to prosecute or prevent drug use per se. It's purely around testing those people who might be driving with drugs in their system who shouldn't be on the roads. Some of the issues that we deal with, as I said before, it's a time-consuming process. The process with the Draeger test could take up to half an hour from go to woe if it was a positive test for the first test. The process with the new twin wipe is slightly shorter, but there is still quite a time impost on the officers on the side of the road when they go to the process of testing someone. We then have to have that confirmed by the lab. So the laboratory, which is the chem centre, provide us with the evidentiary process of then moving forward. We can't prosecute someone on the side of the road. We have to have that confirmation done by the chem centre. The preliminary and secondary devices are expensive. I think it's about $30. $30 for just the prelim test. And then there's the laboratory confirmation, which is about $180 for a laboratory confirmation. So when you compare that to alcohol testing, which really apart from once the initial capital cost of buying the machines, you just got to pay for some straws. You can do millions and millions of roadside alcohol tests compared to drug testing, so it's a cost issue for us. And this is where the science kicks in. You can see around about 2015, we started doing a lot more testing. And part of that was because we had a lot more money, of course. And a lot of those tests, and I don't have the data here, were in regional WA, because the research was telling us you need to do more tests, and you need to be doing more tests in the regional WA. And so that's what we did. This year, I think we're on track for a bit over 37,000 roadside oral fluid tests. That's our plan anyway, and to increase those in the out years. As I said, without the injection of funds, it wouldn't have been possible, but the research definitely gave us some impetus to move those. You can see the percentage of charges per test. We're back now to about 9.69%, and this is where we need to be cautious when you start using police data for research, is that a lot of the data sets are driven by, or influenced heavily by, officer behaviour. So they've talked about random versus targeted. In about 2015, there was a lot of targeted testing going on. This is when we started ramping things up. We're trying to keep control of them, and the instructions to the officers were, these are expensive, or the perception was from the officers, well, these are expensive, you need to be making sure that you're getting bang for buck in terms of your roadside oral fluid testing. We're now saying to them, you need to be doing a lot more random testing as well, because there's a general deterrence has to be factored into. Specific deterrence is important, but the general deterrence also, we think, is a big thing to be thinking about. Which is what I've been speaking about. Because what we often find with the purely random tests, we get positive results from people that we would never have thought of would be firstly using methamphetamine and then driving with methamphetamine. School teachers, police officers, everyone from across society, this affects everyone. A lot more people than you might be thinking of. So the randomness of the testing program, we think that's a big part of it. We'll go specific deterrence, we'll do targeted testing, but the results are always higher, of course, because our officers' perceptions are normally pretty good. The people that they target normally end up actually being people who may, in fact, have methamphetamine in their system, but the random testing still generates some really significant surprises in terms of numbers and the sorts of people that might be not expecting to test. And so, the whole random thing, even though we say to our officers, this is about random testing, sometimes biases and other things kick in. Because we start talking about, well, where do we set the tests up? And we know if we go down to certain regional areas, we're going to get very, very high, even with a random testing procedure, we're going to get very, very high results in terms of those, particularly methamphetamine rats. It's no secret that Bunbury measures very highly in the wastewater sampling. Apologies to anyone from Bunbury, local government tourism area, but it's true. And they also affect it very highly when it comes to rates in terms of roadside testing. So when you do the testing, the officer discretion is a big part of it as well. And one thing I'll just leave you to think about is, because of the fact that we had to involve it on roadside oral fluid testing into our process, we had an existing procedure and existing infrastructure with alcohol testing, which worked and was great, let's do it. So we've been using we'll piggyback it onto that. But alcohol use and drug use, they're not the same thing. even though I talked about, you know, there are outliers or people, but particularly people who are using drugs aren't always the same people, or sorry, the other way around, people who use alcohol aren't always the people who are using drugs. There's different behavioural and social and different health aspects with drug use as to alcohol use. So do we need to be thinking about a different methodology for targeting that when it comes to enforcement? And I'll leave that question floating for maybe for later on.
Thank you. Plenty of food for thought there. And now we're on to the alcohol aspects, and we will be welcoming you back, Scott, again. But in the meantime, we're welcoming Dr. Michelle Hopday. And Michelle, gosh, what an interesting career you've had. You're now with the Curtin Monash Centre. You're a physiotherapist from South Africa. You worked with people recovering from road crashes, so you've really been at the practical end and been an expert witness for many road crashes, and then relocated to, then did a master's in public health, examined collisions in which pedestrians were fatally killed or seriously injured, then moved to Perth in 2010, completed your PhD, congratulations, in 2014, working with the National Drug Research Institute, well known across the country, of course, and located at Curtin. So please come and share your thoughts about alcohol.
Good afternoon. So I'm going to be sharing the results of a study I did for the Road Safety Commission last year on alcohol and outlets. And as Peter mentioned, this is part of a larger report, which you can obtain from the CMARC website or from me. And some of the results, well, the results from this presentation have also been published in Accident Analysis and Prevention a couple of months ago. So there's a body of research linking alcohol and road crashes. As is widely known, alcohol causes reduced attention, slower responses of the eyes, hands, and feet, varying muscular responses, and increased risk-taking behavior. And it's been shown famously in the initial Grand Rapids study that there is a response as the blood alcohol concentration, or BAC, increases, there's an exponential increase in risk of crash. There's also been previous research into the effects of alcohol outlet density, which is the number of alcohol outlets in a certain area, on alcohol-related harms, such as assault, but also including road crashes. The results have been mixed with regard to road crashes, and I feel that this is probably likely because of two conflicting issues. The one is driving exposure. So the further you drive, having consumed alcohol, the more likely you are to crash. But then as you travel further from an alcohol outlet, such as a nightclub or hotel, the effect of that outlet decreases. So the aim of the study was to look at the effect of the number of alcohol outlets at different distances from crashes in the Perth metropolitan area. So I'm going to go fairly quickly through the methods because it's the kind of thing that only interests epidemiologists. But as I say, you're welcome to chat to me more about the methods later or look at the report. So this study looked at 11 years of data. We obtained the alcohol outlet licensing data from the Department of Racing, Gaming and Liquor. We also obtained socioeconomic and demographic data at postcode level from the ABS. And then crash data from main roads, Western Australia. And the useful aspect of this particularly was that we had the location details of each crash, so the longitude and latitude, which enabled the analysis. So an alcohol-related crash, for the purposes of the study, was defined as there being at least one driver involved in the crash with a BAC of 0.05 or above, so above the legal alcohol limit. And a non-alcohol-related crash, we used what's called a surrogate measure because of the varying levels of measurement of BAC. And we used all daytime crashes between 7 in the morning and 6 p.m. at night. And this is the reason why. So I'm just going to fiddle with my handy little doodah. So if you have a look here, the blue line shows all crashes that occurred in the Perth metro area over the 11-year period. And you can see there's a huge rise. Most of the crashes occurred during the daytime hours. Okay. Then the red line has a look at the distribution of BAC, positive crashes, or those above the legal limit over the 24-hour period. And you can see that the vast majority of them occur sort of after 8, 9 at night, and that then drops again as we get towards sort of 7 in the morning. So these crashes were considered highly likely to be non-alcohol related, whereas the crashes at night were very much more likely to be above the legal limit. So the analysis was done using a geographic information system, or a GIS, which is just a fancy type of map where a lot of data has been inputted. We used road network shapefiles. The crashes were also plotted on the GIS, as were the alcohol outlets. They were plotted separately as bottle shops or on-premises outlets, which would be your nightclubs, restaurants, etc. Postcodes were also categorized according to distance from the CBD, and I'll show this more in the next diagrams. So this is a little sort of screenshot of the area just south of the river around Burswood, Vic Park sort of area. You can see the lines, obviously the road network. There's the river, and the triangles indicate the position of the different alcohol outlets in this area, and the different coloured dots indicate the crashes. So different coloured dots.
Where some of the triangles are, it's hard to tell.
Sorry, it's a bit blurred because it's been enlarged, but there I think is a little triangle there.
So that's an outlet.
That's an alcohol outlet, that's a crash. Right. The crashes are the circles. So some of those crashes are daytime crashes. This is just an example, though. So.
And how long a period was that over?
That's 11 years.
Right.
Yeah. So, and this is another aspect of the... So what we did as part of the analysis is we separated Perth into four different zones. The thought being that in the CBD, for example, your traffic signals are very close together. As you go further and further out from the CBD, the nature of the traffic changes, traffic signals are further apart, people travel longer distances, roads become progressively, on the whole, less congested as you get into the outer suburbs. So here's the CBD, then all the postcodes sort of up to 7 kilometres from the CBD were included here, and then from 7 to 15 kilometres, that's your next zone. And then all postcodes beyond 15 kilometres from the CBD were included there. And this methodology was based on a report done by ARB a few years ago. The statistical analysis used various methods, including descriptive analysis, heat maps, and regression modelling. So in the GIS, I did various calculations. So let's take, for example, you've got your little purple alcohol outlet here, and measured the distance in the GIS along a route from each alcohol outlet to each crash. So here's the alcohol outlet, and for each of these crashes, measured the distance, the route along the road network to each crash. And that was used in the analysis. And now what we did for each crash, so here's a red crash, we looked at how many alcohol outlets were established within 2 kilometres, within 5 kilometres, within 10 kilometres, and within 20 kilometres of each crash. I won't go into this in detail, but just to show that of all the crashes that were measured, so 340,000 crashes over the 11-year period, 2.2% of them had known BACs above the legal alcohol limit, and this is likely to be an underestimate, but this was the measurement in the database, and 74% of the crashes occurred between 7 in the morning and 6 at night. And this is looking at incidence rates, so that's the number of crashes per population. The highest incidence rates for both alcohol-related and non-alcohol-related crashes occurred in the CBD. You can see that outside the CBD, alcohol-related crashes remains at similar levels, whereas with just the daytime or the non-alcohol-related crashes, this incidence rate dropped to its lowest incidence beyond 15 kilometers from the CBD. So this is a heat map. So this is taking all the crashes and estimating areas with the highest density of crashes, which are the red areas, and the blue areas are the areas with the lowest density of crashes. You can see this is the BAC crash on the left. You can see obviously there were a lot less BAC crashes than there were average daytime crashes. But you can also see that they're much more discrete. So instead of being a big blur of red with a bit of blue on the outside, you can actually pick up certain areas beyond the CBD. I'm at a very bad angle, so I'm afraid I can't see my own slide to show you very well. But you can see the CBD here. You can see places like, my geography is going to fall apart here, sort of Fremantle around there. Then you're getting to kind of Rockingham down there, and then as you go further down, Mandurah, and as you go further up the coast, you can actually see areas like Hillary's, etc., where there are higher densities of crashes, and then beyond that. I'm not going to talk about this slide, but it's here for the sake of completeness. So this is the regression model that was done, and I'll discuss the results in a more palatable form. So the results showed, as there was an increase in the number of on-premises outlets adjacent to the crash was more likely to be an alcohol-related crash or a non-alcohol-related crash. So I'll just repeat that. A crash was more likely to be alcohol-related than non-alcohol-related if there was a high number of on-premises outlets nearby. We think why this is the case. Often areas that have a large number of alcohol outlets clustered together, this often occurs in built-up areas, so your entertainment districts, your obviously CBD, Fremantle, Joondalup, places on the coast where there's a large number of outlets in an entertainment area, and you may have a lot of drivers interacting in a more built-up area. People, for example, a lot of people may have been drinking, some at legal limits, some below, but still slightly impaired. And so crashes are more likely to occur as these drivers interact with each other on the road than if there were fewer outlets. And as I mentioned, in more built-up areas, driving is more complex, there are more traffic signals, more small hazards to deal with in more built-up roads. The model also showed that beyond 10 kilometers from a crash, when there were more outlets, the crashes were more likely to be alcohol related. This is possibly due to delayed increase in BAC. So a lot of people will have their last drink at a nightclub or a hotel just before they leave. And research has shown it takes kind of 35 to 60 minutes for your BAC to reach its peak. So you may have your drink, go to the loo, get into your car, start driving, and as you're a certain number of minutes into your drive, you've done your sort of 10, 15 Ks, that's when your peak BAC kicks in, and that may be when you're more likely to have your crash as you start becoming tired and you're more intoxicated. Let's not start getting on the fatigue as well. And also, as I mentioned before, the issue of driving exposure occurs. So if you've been driving already for 10, 15 kilometers, you're just more likely to have a crash because your exposure is greater from more driving. The associations with bottle shops or off-premises outlets are more complex, and this has been shown in other studies in the areas of alcohol-related harm. But basically, the conclusion that I would draw is that distance between alcohol outlet or between a bottle shop and a crash is a less important issue than it is with on-premises outlets. So issues such as sale levels may be a better indicator of crash risk than actually the number of alcohol outlets. Furthermore, alcohol-related crashes were more likely to occur beyond the CBD if you controlled for the number of alcohol outlets. So if there was a similar number of alcohol outlets in each area, actually your outer areas are more at risk. And finally, crashes are less likely to be alcohol involved in postcodes with higher socioeconomic status and higher mean ages. So the recommendations from this. So it's recommended that locations should be identified with higher risk of alcohol-related crashes, which can be done with the aid of the heat maps and other maps that were produced as part of the report, and that countermeasures be used in these specific locations. So as Kyle mentioned, was talking about runoff roads, alcohol-related crashes are most commonly single vehicle crashes, so often runoff roads. So countermeasures such as flexible wire barriers are useful. Then also reduction of speeds, particularly in entertainment districts where you're dealing with complex road situations to reduce the injury risk or reduce the severity of injury. Also targeted roadside breath testing focus areas. It's important, it's been shown in previous research that the areas with clusters of outlets are important target areas, but then also residential areas as well. And then finally, issues relating to liquor licensing, such as avoiding creating these clusters, or at least reducing the size of the clusters, and then looking at aspects such as the size, parking, and discounting of prices at bottle shops. Thank you.
See the prelim breath tests, or alcohol tests as we call them, have increased dramatically and are going to continue to increase over the years. Particular health and road trauma trust account in terms of funding those tests, but you can see in WA the number of tests that we've been performing over the last few years has been increasing dramatically. The plan for us is to, as a bare minimum, match licensed drivers per test. So one per licensed driver per year is the plan. It's a very rough rule of thumb testing process or a numbering process, but that's what we're aiming for. I reckon about 2.2 million this year. We're aiming for a minimum of 1.8, and I think we're going to get about 2.2 million this year. And they're saying that the challenge for us now is to maintain that. Okay, so just a quick discussion around alcohol testing and the way that we look at in WA Police. There's purely random breath tests, so that you may see, for those of you who are looking at WA Police data, we talk about random breath tests, preliminary tests. The way that our officers think about it is, so with a random test, it's purely random. It's just, it doesn't matter who you are. It's mostly done through the large buses. We will just stop everyone who drives past, or not everyone, but even as much as we can. And we'll also do that with single vehicle patrol. So you might get a couple of motorbikes or a couple of cars and pull over the side of the road and just randomly select drivers for testing. The preliminary tests are, for us, the instruction are for our officers, every vehicle stop should result in an alcohol test. Every vehicle stop should have an alcohol test. For whatever reason, that's the instruction that we give our officers. That doesn't always work, so they don't always do what they're told, but they're pretty good actually. They'll mostly try to do that. And the preliminary tests also can be more targeted. So we'll go off and we'll target areas and people purely for the purposes of alcohol testing, rather than just stop every single one coming along. Actually, one thing before I talk about that is, before I talk about specific deterrence, is that we also need to maintain our general deterrence. And so that's why you'll see the bus out at during the daytime, in times when, in locations when you might be thinking, well, there's not too many alcohol users or alcohol crashes at 11 o'clock on a busy highway. There actually are. There's quite a lot you know, our officers will come across drink drivers regularly at those times or locations and hours where most of us would think that people wouldn't be drinking, particularly not drinking and driving, but we do come across them. But more generally, the idea is just to get into the minds of people, doesn't matter where, doesn't matter when, any time, any place, alcohol testing will take place. That's the idea, getting to people's head. So you might get tested only once per year, but after you've been tested, it doesn't really matter when that test happened, it's in your mind. So when you hop into your car, or think about hopping into your car after you've been drinking, that test you took, doesn't matter where or when, is hopefully in the back of your mind. We're hoping you don't do it because it's the wrong thing to do, but we're also hoping that, you know, sometimes people don't do things for the right reasons, they do them because what's in it for me. So the specific deterrence aspect is, what we'll do is, even with the large buses, even though they're mostly used for random testing, we'll put the buses, which are normally random testing, in large scale, and the KPIs for these guys is slightly lower, so we'll put them in those areas where you might get a bit of a lower volume of vehicles, but in those areas where you might expect higher alcohol incidence. So around Fremantle, around Northbridge, put them in spots which don't get a great deal of traffic coming past, but they're the best places to put buses, obviously. What we'll also do is, to include into that, because we know that people can be a little bit sneaky, and once the social media machine kicks in, it doesn't take long for a booze bus to set up, but then people start messaging each other. We'll send a little hunter-gatherer groups. So each of those buses comes with two or three cars. And those cars will spend lots of time going out in the back streets or side streets. And funnily enough, guess what you find out there? Not just rat runners, but also drinkers. So cops might look stupid, but eventually we'll these things out. And so we call that the webbing operation. So the buses will go out, the big numbers will go out there, but they'll also send a bus doing purely the webbing operation. And again, lower volume but much higher hit rate, depending on where you're going. Northbridge, traditionally, I think we get about, a usual RBT, about 0.5%, I think, is the hit rate. It's about 1%, and sometimes even higher, up to 2% in places like Northbridge. We sent out a bus to Kalgoorlie last race round, and by the time we got to the Sunday, there was no one. Even with the webbing going on, they just stopped. In Kalgoorlie, who'd have thought? Again, it wasn't a matter of avoiding it, because we had the webbing cars going around, they stopped drinking and driving for that week in the course. They worked out eventually. So we'll also do, not just with the buses, but we'll also go and sit off entertainment precincts or, you know, certain alcohol outlets where we know are going to be high hit rates and high value targets. We'll send marked cars, unmarked cars, not the bus, but just as many cars as we can. And again, we get a much higher hit rate through them. A lot of this is obviously might sound like common sense, but the office is based that on intelligence and based on research. So there is some science that goes around it. As I said, so we think about those kinds of things which are going to result in not just high volumes, but also higher returns in terms of getting people off the road who shouldn't be drinking and driving. Certainly, who shouldn't be driving. Those are people who are going to have higher alcohol concentrations than others. So where do you go? When do you go? Again, I spoke about the general deterrence. You might see buses out there at 10 or 11 in the morning, but also you see more predominantly those buses around those times and dates in locations where research and intelligence tells us they're going to find drinkers and drivers. I'll be quick because I know that there's time, questions coming later on. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so you're going to find us, that's the message.
Thank you.
So, fatigue driving. Again, I guess quite often if you've had a drink, you might feel a bit drowsy as well. And I bet we've all had that awful sensation of beginning to just get the eyes droopy. And we've got to think about fatigue driving. So we have, again, a tech team, Dr. Kim Ward and Morgan Enderfield. So just a little bit to share with you. Dr. Kim Ward, again, from the Curtin Monash Centre. A great deal of experience, clinical experience as a sleep scientist at the WA Sleep Disorders Research Institute, Department of Health. PhD in 2016, congratulations, on obstructive sleep apnea and crash risk. So completely pertinent to what we're talking about today. And then the other part of the tag team is to move across. So let me find my notes on Morgan. Where are you, Morgan? You're right at the front here, I think, yeah. Road Safety Commission's Principal Policy Officer with experience across public and community sectors. Bachelor of Arts and Law with honours, congratulations. Now studying Masters in Law, Policy and Government at UWA. You're going to graduate this semester, almost there. So look forward to that. So we'll be looking forward to hearing both from Kim and from Morgan about fatigue.
Thank you very much to the Road Safety Commission for inviting me to speak to you today about fatigue and road crashes. In 2016, 196 people died on WA roads, 120 in the regional areas and 76 in the metro area. As Ian mentioned earlier, about 70% of all serious crashes are due to human error, not risk-taking. And common behavioural factors include alcohol use, speed, fatigue and inattention. Of the 196 deaths, 27 fatalities, or 14%, were involved in fatigue-related crashes. And of equal concern to fatalities are the large number of serious injuries due to crashes. Work presented by Ben Beck, a Monash researcher at the Road Safety Conference in Perth last year, reported that serious injury rates have not declined between 2007 and 2015. And internationally, about 20% of fatal crashes are estimated to be related to fatigue. So what is fatigue? In road safety, our definition of fatigue is a condition of sleepiness, tiredness, or drowsiness that increases risk of crash for a driver. No matter what name you use for fatigue, the common outcome is that fatigue causes cognitive impairment that impacts on our ability to drive safely, because driving is a complex task that requires attention, vigilance, perception, judgment, and adequate response time. So sleep loss impairs all of these cognitive skills needed to drive safely. Whoops. I became interested in the risks of drowsy driving through my role as a senior scientist at the sleep clinic at Charles Gardner. Doctors were frequently requesting urgent sleep studies on patients that they were concerned about due to their drowsy driving risk. And we use a questionnaire called the Epworth Sleepiness Score, with scores that range from 0 to 24. And when patients have a high score, indicating that they're sleepy, they're advised to limit or stop driving if they're excessively sleepy until their diagnosis is made. So this is a model of fatigue that I'd just like to walk through with you. In 2009, May and Baldwin proposed this model to account for decreases in driving performance and increased crash risk. So driving causes fatigue if it either overloads or understimulates the driver in relation to demands. And examples of task-related fatigue, which is this one here, are a long time spent driving, more demand on the driver in heavy traffic, poor weather or night driving, and the need to do a secondary task, such as find an address. Examples of passive task-related fatigue or underload are country driving, which is monotonous and involves long distances, familiar driving in the city where we zone out as we're driving, and automated systems such as cruise control can lead to understimulation. And finally, examples of sleep-related fatigue can relate to the time of day that you're driving. There's more risk between 2 and 5 in the morning and 1 and 3 in the afternoon, whether or not you're fully rested, and whether or not you may have an untreated sleep disorder. Finally, note that both active and passive task-related fatigue can worsen sleep-related fatigue. They're interrelated. So it's a little bit like the alcohol and drug combination. If you have all three, you're in deep trouble. So to summarise the causes of fatigue in driving, the driving task itself and the surrounding environment contribute to fatigue by overtaxing or understimulating the driver. However, good sleep is crucial to safe driving, and today I'll focus on sleep-related fatigue. So three components define healthy sleep. Most adults need 7 to 8 hours sleep a day. A recent survey of Australians found that self-reported inadequate sleep, either short or poor quality, affects 33 to 45% of adults. We must time our sleep correctly at night. Our circadian clock ensures that our sleep is timed to night. Shift workers struggle to sleep well during the day as they are working in opposition to their natural rhythm. And our sleep must be of good quality, not disrupted by sleep disorders, medical conditions, or sedating medications. So sleep disorders are common. The most common are sleep apnea, restless legs, and insomnia. I'd now just like to walk you through an important experiment that illustrates the relationship between fatigue, alcohol, and performance impairment. In 1997, Drew Dawson did an important study that helped us understand how significant sleep loss is in relation to driving. 40 subjects participated in two experiments. In one, they were kept awake for 28 hours from 8 in the morning till noon the following day. And in the other, they were asked to consume one standard drink at 30-minute intervals from 8 in the morning until their mean blood alcohol concentration reached 0.1%. They then had their cognitive function or reaction time measured at half hourly intervals. And the results are expressed as a percentage of the performance at the start of the session. Performance decline with increasing alcohol was compared with performance decline associated with increasing time awake. So these two graphs that I have displayed here, the top one is the hours of wakefulness with increasing time awake on the x-axis and performance decrement on the y-axis. And the lower graph is increasing blood alcohol concentration on the x and the same relative performance on the y. And what they found was that performance decreased significantly in both conditions at relatively similar rates. And the message was, if you drive after 17 hours without sleep, your driving performance is as bad as driving with a blood alcohol level of 0.05%. Now, this is a common scenario for many people, particularly young drivers. If you wake for work at 6 in the morning, work all day, have dinner, play sport in the evening, by 11 o'clock, 17 hours have elapsed, and you need to understand that your driving is likely impaired. So who's most at risk of drowsy driving? Young adults, those who've consumed alcohol, which Michelle has pointed out to us, shift workers, 20% of our community are shift workers. That's a lot of people sleeping in opposition to their body clock. Commercial drivers who drive, you know, lots more than the rest of us, so their risk has increased. People who work long hours, sleep-deprived people, if you happen to have a poor night's sleep and you sleep less than 6 hours, your risk is increased. People taking sedative medications and people with sleep disorders. In 2017, just last year, the results of a survey of 1,011 Australian adults found that 29% of people reported driving while drowsy in the past month, 20% have nodded off while driving, and 5% have had a crash in the past year because they dozed off. So poor alertness is unfortunately common in modern society due to inadequate sleep and untreated sleep disorders. And unfortunately, unlike illicit drugs and alcohol, there's no easily applied roadside measurement tool for fatigue and drowsiness. However, the future's bright. We can assist occupational drivers. Good research is underway to help commercial drivers. In 2013, a cooperative research centre for alertness, safety and productivity was funded by the federal government and is working on alertness measurement, prediction and testing. So fatigue monitoring systems use physiological measures to detect and warn about microsleeps in real time. There are several eye movement measurements that are useful: eye blinks, slow eye movements, eyelid closure and pupil size. So this graphic here, with a little picture of a man, is a Seeing Machines product, which is an operational system fitted to trucks with two cameras seat vibration, audio alert, and messages going back to a safeguard centre. That's been installed in the whole toll trucking fleet. This little pair of yellow glasses here is the OptAlert system. They are glasses that monitor eyelid movements to generate a drowsiness score, and they give real-time feedback to both the operator and to a base, and they're already being used in mining operations, both overseas and in Australia. And the SmartCap technology, this one here, is a slightly different system. It's a wearable technology that eliminates microsleeps. There's a sensor strip that fits into the cap, and it uses your brain waves to measure your ability to resist sleep. So all of these are operational systems that have been validated and are out in the community now to help manage fatigue while driving. And they give feedback directly to the user, and if the user doesn't respond, it's going back to the base, and the base has systems where they can contact the driver. So I think in the future, this drowsy detection technology is going to be critical to improve our road safety. But in the meantime, what about you and I? What are some countermeasures that we can use for our drowsy driving? So until such time as alertness technology is widely available to the general public, we, all drivers, that's probably all of us here, are personally responsible to manage our own fatigue as follows. So you need to ensure that you get enough sleep. On long drives, you should take breaks. It's been shown scientifically that a 15-minute nap is long enough to lower your risk of crash if you're feeling drowsy. You shouldn't drink alcohol and drive. You shouldn't drive late at night. If you need to drive a long distance, you need to ensure that you get a good sleep the night before. And does caffeine help driving? Yes, it does. Caffeine can improve alertness for 1 to 2 hours. It's a stimulant, so you should avoid it at least 4 hours before going to sleep. And it's present in coffee, tea, soft drinks and chocolate. But you should limit your intake to 200 milligrams a day, which is equivalent to 2 cups of coffee, 3 cups of tea, 2.5 Red Bull, or 3 chocolate bars. And that Sleep Foundation, just in case you were wondering, that Sleep Health Foundation website I put there has some fantastic drowsy driving tips for you. So in summary, there's strong evidence that fatigue and sleepiness increase our risk of driving crashes. Sleep loss and drowsy driving are prevalent in the community. Poor performance, driving crashes and injuries due to reduced alertness are preventable. Technologies that detect driver drowsiness are available for commercial drivers. But we need strategies to improve behaviour in relation to fatigue management and healthy sleep to minimise fatigue-related crashes. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks, Kim, and hello everyone. Today I will be presenting a summary of government's response to the fatigue crash problem from a road safety perspective. The aim of this presentation is to position the problem of fatigue crashes into a broader conversation that brings into the limelight the root cause of fatigue being a lack of restorative sleep. So, what is the WA crash problem? As highlighted in Kim's presentation, fatigue-related crashes. As highlighted in Kim's presentation, fatigue-related crashes generally involve run-off road and head-on crashes, both of which continue to feature as major crash types in WA's crash statistics. In 2016, 27 people lost their lives due to fatigue-related crashes. The commercial vehicle industry is also a key at-risk demographic. From 2005 to 16, there were 206 fatigue-related killed and seriously injured crashes involving heavy vehicles on our roads, representing approximately 12% of heavy vehicle KSI crashes over this time. But this isn't the complete picture, with experts arguing that fatigue-related crashes are often underreported. This is partly due to the different proxy measures adopted by jurisdictions to formally record fatigue as a contributing factor to crash. The problem is also complicated by the fact that Fatigue is inherently a health matter, with the responsibility ultimately residing with the individual to ensure they get enough sleep and that this is quality sleep. However, unlike a drunk or drugged driver, our ability to detect whether we are fatigued at a point in time is hard. People may feel fine when they get into their car, with the effects of fatigue not hitting them until a few hours later. Or people may mistake the signs of fatigue with tiredness and continue to push on, unknowingly putting themselves and other road users at risk. The workplace and our road network also bring into play factors such as the general health and well-being of the industry, health and safety regulation and compliance, employer and allocator pressures, the remoteness, isolation, extreme weather, and infrastructure along the WA network. Our ability to understand the cause of fatigue and the context in which heightens its risk are quintessential if we are going to truly make progress in reducing fatigue-related KSI crashes to zero. So, what are we doing about this? As highlighted by our Acting Commissioner, the Safe System approach positions human beings at the heart of the system. The approach aligns with contemporary thinking across jurisdictions in relation to policy design, using behavioural insights. Approaches need to be adjusted from the traditional to the system-based thinking, using infrastructure and vehicle technology where possible to better support decision-making. Towards Zero recognised fatigue as a contributing issue to our crash problem, and recommended specific initiatives to address this. This included exploration into fatigue warning systems, as well as programs to address fatigue driving. Since commencing the strategy, the government, industry, and community continue to work together on these initiatives. Some examples to date include the Commission's recent fatigue campaign, Don't Trust Your Tired Self, which was adopted from Transport for New South Wales. The Runoff Road Program, as discussed earlier, where audible edge lines are used to mitigate runoff road crashes. Investment into rest areas for all drivers. However, within this area, we recognise issues with respect to the number of rest areas along the network, the accessibility of rest areas for all road users, but especially heavy vehicles, and the disparity in the facilities provided depending on road user type. Industry's involvement in the trialling and testing of fatigue warning systems has also been significant in our ability to get greater visibility into the benefits and costs of in-vehicle technology to manage fatigue. Also, the amazing work by Roadwise, the not-for-profit sector, and our local volunteers in supporting initiatives such as Driver Reviver along our road network. So, where to next? With the consequences of fatigue often depicted from a road trauma lens, the Commission is being looked to as the leaders in responding to this issue. With this in mind, I note that legislation has been adopted in America to prohibit fatigue driving. However, there is more work to be done in WA to understand what a fit-for-purpose policy design looks like here. Investment in road safety initiatives are only part of the solution. We must begin to start dealing with the root cause of this issue. This involves putting a person's health and genuine ability to obtain restorative sleep at the heart of policy design. This is because fatigue driving is a consequence of fatigue. If we are able to effectively address fatigue at the front end, then we are in turn able to minimise the risk of fatigue drivers on our roads. The problem needs to be considered holistically to ensure that our road safety outcomes are interconnected with health outcomes, as well as peripheral portfolio outcomes, such as the commercial and industrial relations. Going forward, the Commission will leverage the research across academia and industry and further engagement with our stakeholders on this issue from a whole of community perspective. By doing this, we will be best placed to genuinely address fatigue and thereby support all WA road users. This includes our commercial vehicle industry, who day in and day out provide the essential services to all our communities across WA, and without them, we wouldn't have the fabulous economy we have or be the amazing state we are. Thank you.
That was just
just fantastic, and I don't know about in WA, but I was hearing in New South Wales, for example, that truck drivers can drive for 15 hours with just 2 15-minute breaks. And you just wonder, you know, whether that's the right thing, I don't know. You mentioned that 15-minute breaks sometimes make a big difference. I'd like to know whether coffee and chocolate is synergistic so I can do both at one time. We're going to be a little bit short of time to have a panel at the front, but we would have time for just a couple of quick questions before lunch. And if you could say who you are and specify who you'd like to answer or whether it's more general. So if the lights can come up, please. If we've got one or two burning questions, if not, I think we've got a lot to think about in this session already. So any burning questions, please? Yes, please.
Just a really
gentleman there and then the lady down here, yeah?
Just a really quick one. Brendan from Main Road, Scott Higgins. I was just wondering how long the delay is from a drug test, roadside drug test, to the lab result and then that driver actually finding out that it was positive. It's just for my own interest, really.
purely academic interest.
You can tell your friend. Well, from the time it leaves our breath and drug operations to the Kimson Rebecca's, about a week, and then it comes down to how quick it can take us to track the driver down. So it might just be a day or two, or depending on how hard they made themselves to find, can be longer than that. That's the problem. So what we're trying to do at a national level, we're pushing the driver and others to come up with a roadside evidentiary test, the same way you can have an alcohol roadside test, and on your way up, just roadside test. We're asking the manufacturers, because I'm just taking a bit more time than usual. Australia actually leads the way when it comes to roadside drug testing in terms of numbers and quality and a push for it. So there's not a great deal of market out there in the international community for these kinds of devices. So we're pushing them to come up with something which gives us an evidentiary test at the roadside.
There we go. Happy with that answer?
Yes, I'm just interested to know that delay, just to know how long it takes to get those drivers infringed and off the road.
Exactly.
And so one other thing, government is working on what we're calling a prohibition notice. So once the person gives us a prima facie indication that they're positive, we can serve them the prohibition notice for 24 hours, 2 days, to keep them off the road while this system drops.
So just from preliminary tests, that's enough. No driving for 2 days.
Yes,
jolly good idea. Thank you. Yes, lady there had a question. Do you want to follow up that answer first, and then we'll come to you. There we go.
Hello, Anna from RAC. I had a question for Scott and Michelle regarding alcohol outlets and on-premise alcohol outlets, mainly around pedestrians and cyclists who may be impaired and exposing themselves to the risk of crash. Did any of your research consider impaired walkers, pedestrians, and cyclists?
No.
Well, there's a job for you for the next year.
Yes, I'm coming to my soapbox now. 4 years. No, well, obviously the problem is there's no legislation around impaired cyclists, I don't know if there's about impaired cyclists. There's nothing formal, certainly not for pedestrians. So we don't know. Obviously the numbers are rather small to do the type of analysis that I did with that, but I feel very strongly about the fact that there should be some legislation around impaired cyclists and impaired pedestrians. I'm climbing off my soapbox now.
Well, this is a chance for a soapbox, is why we need it. Yes, please, comment here. And then I think we're just gonna squeeze in one more question. We've got another word.
Andy Robinson from Health. Question for Peter.
Yes.
I was very interested in the cannabis and the impact it has on fatality. One of the issues we are increasingly getting is the use of medicinal cannabis, and that's going to obviously become an issue going forward. Now, we at the moment are saying if you're taking medicinal cannabis, you shouldn't be driving, but I'd be interested in what your feelings were on the use of cannabis and driving.
I was hoping nobody had asked me about this. say right at the outset that if you look very critically at the research literature, the findings do vary in terms of impairment associated with drugs, and probably cannabis is the area where there are lots of mixed findings, because there are some jurisdictions, such as in the UK, where you can drive with cannabis in your system quite legally because they have non-zero per se laws, whereas in Australia we have zero tolerance here. So I guess there's an issue of what level THC might be present in those drivers who are taking medicinal cannabis, but I just don't think there's any appetite, really, certainly not amongst police, to accept non-zero per se laws for cannabis. But I agree with you. I think it's raising a question as to how we deal with that and what do you actually say to those users. It is a problem. Maybe Scott has an answer to it from a legislative and enforcement perspective.
Gives us another thing to think about raised by this whole forum. Thank you for that. Now, there was a question up here somewhere. Yes, please, one of our students. Off we go, looking forward to this one. And then after that, I promise it'll be lunch.
I'm Sienna from Paul's Head College, and I've got a question for Scott, mainly. So with learner drivers and P-players and then novice drivers from off their P's, how high are the rates for alcohol and drug-related incidents and stuff?
I don't have the stats in front of me, but...
That's a very good question, isn't it?
Learners, it's very low, really low. P-players, I think it's a lot. Crashes or
if we got a microphone,
it's high. Once you leave the post tutelage, and I think it's
so yeah, it's low for learners, but high
very,
for
very
peers.
Low, really low. In fact, e-players it's abnormally high, and so that's where I mean not we target e-players, but that's where the education part of it has to really kick in.
The 18 threshold across there, wouldn't it? So most adults would
get
below 18. Meaning e-players would be 18. Plus.
Yeah.
So do you see any implications there for specific legislation, other US, where you wouldn't be allowed to drive, say, under a certain age unless you had somebody with you, hopefully, who wouldn't be under the influence of alcohol or anything else?
Well, for L's it's zero, P's two, after you get off your P's. So I suppose the part about you've got the monitored driving with L's, you have to have someone who monitors you with P-players. Quote me, there's nothing at all at the moment, potentially.
Are most P-players, anecdotally, I think of it as a P-player will have lots of their mates in the car as well. Is that a true picture, or are they the solo? We've heard all about the solo driver.
Well, it depends, because you can't make generalisations about people, and often it's good to have one person driving a bunch of people around, because we've got to recognise that young people will go out in groups and they'll be drinking. So we'd rather have one person in the car who's not drinking. So you're going to have large groups of people in the car. That's, I think it's a good thing if that one person's not drinking. I think it helps us to be realistic about what's going to happen in the real world, rather than say, well, you've got large groups of young people in the car, they're going to be playing up. Most of them actually are not playing up.
So is this where the Skipper program comes in, Scott?
Definitely.
Yeah. And is that working? Is that penetrating in the community?
I couldn't tell you for sure, but I think anecdotally, definitely.
Yeah, good to hear. An excellent question. Thank you for all our speakers. We've had a really good session, very topical. And thank you also for the audience for your participation and close interest. So a round of applause for our presenters. And back, let's make it 5 minutes later at 1:50, please. And please continue conversations.